So welcome to today's lecture. Is the microphone actually working? Yeah, seems so. Okay, so today we're going to talk about statistical visualization. So originally we plan to do statistical modeling first, but I thought it's actually easier to first talk about statistical visualization so we can visualize what we model in the end more easily. And so we already had a lecture, a whole lecture about matplotlib and how you can make very customized plots. But statistical visualization has a bit different aim, where you really want to focus on visualizing data in a specific way, and usually data that is already in a tidy format. So, and it's a very important part of exploratory data analysis, because we as humans are visual beings, so to say, and it's most easy for us to understand data when we can actually see something. And once we know that we can make some assumptions about the data that we have, it's actually much more easier to create plots than it is if we make not so many assumptions and only can use matplotlib. So this whole field of statistical visualization, or like the process of statistical visualization, is often framed in a grammar of graphics. So what is that? There was a very influential book in the beginning of the early 2000s by Wilkinson, I believe, which was called The Grammar of Graphics, where basically, so to say, real grammar was described, how you can describe any two-dimensional statistical plot without, and so not in an imperative mode, but where you really want to declaratively describe how your plot looks in relation to the data, and then you pass this to some rendering system, and so you only have to think about how you want your data and or how you want the plot to look, but you don't really have to think about low-level details. So on this original grammar was framed with the following things. So we have variables, which are just what we have in a data frame. So we say each column in a data frame is a variable. Then they defined a whole algebra where you can have some symbols, how you can relate, different variables from your data frame. So this would be just things like group by and joining and merging. So this whole thing. Then you have scales where you say, okay, you want to have, you have different levels of measurement, so this nominal or ratio level or so, and now you want to map somehow your measurement to something visual. And then you have also statistics, so that you can automatically compute certain statistics on your data just by describing them. Then you have things like geometry, where you say, okay, you have geometric objects that you want to see in the end, like lines and polygons and points and so. And then you have also different coordinate systems that you could describe the same plot in a Cartesian or polar coordinate system. And then in the end, you have these aesthetics, where you say, okay, now you want to map your data to something that is perceivable by us, like shape or color. And you can actually read the book. It's actually very interesting to read, because like the first part is really on this whole grammar of graphics, where they try to figure out a good way to concisely describe all different kinds of plots. And then the second part of the book is about semantics of different plots and where you can learn which plot you should use in which situation. So then there were like, so they had an implementation of this, but this is not really widely used. But instead, there are a lot of other implementations now in Python that are based on this idea of a grammar of graphics, of declaratively describing your plot instead of imperatively describing what you want to draw. However, there's not really a single library where you say, okay, this is the thing that that everybody is using. So, and this brings us to one of the most sometimes gruesome or most fun parts of programming. This is technology choices. So you can lose an endless amount of time by thinking about which library to choose over which one. And usually you will find that whichever one you use, no one is that much better that it's really worthwhile discussing the whole day. But instead, what I would recommend you is that you choose one that you like, and then you really try to get good at it and use it for some time. And really, when you find that you too often the library that you're using is too limited, then you might consider switching. But I feel that we are like spending way too much time thinking about, okay, this is a bit better, this has this feature, whatever, but in the end it doesn't really matter. So, and what is also important, and if you really want to make or evaluate different technology choices, you should think beforehand about what your requirements are. So what also often happens that people start using different stuff, and then in the end everybody likes something else, but no one ever thought before about what do we really need and what really satisfies our requirements. Okay, so enough talk about this. Let's actually look at the options that we have here. So there is a built-in plotting module in pandas already. So you might have already seen this is when you have a data frame, you can just call .plot on the data frame and pass different arguments there. And this already is kind of inspired with the option that it has by the grammar of graphics. And so I made some pros and cons list here for the different packages or the different options that we have here. So the good thing is that we don't need to add an extra dependency. We already have pandas anyway, and it's relatively quick and easy. And this is built on matplotlib, so you can use this to easily make the plots that you like. And if you really need to do some customization, in the end you can still use everything you know from matplotlib, and it's as it is in pandas, it has very good support because pandas has very good support. However, it does have limited capabilities, and also by default the look is not very nice, to be honest. Then there's a package that we are going to focus mostly on today, which is called plot9, aka ggplot2, you could say. So ggplot2 is the R package that is like the default plotting standard in the R world. That is obviously implemented by Hadley Wickham, who like implemented all the famous R packages. And this is, so to say, built on top or like really strongly inspired by the original grammar of graphics from Wilkinson, but it has a bit different parameterization, and it works really great and offers great composability, as you will learn shortly. So the pros are that it is already standard in R. So the cool thing is, like, when you talk to other data science people who work in R, you can talk about the same thing in the same language. Really, as I said, it is really a composable grammar. You can think about things that you want to do, and you can easily express this using ggplot. And it is also customizable with matplotlib, so at least the Python version. But to be honest, it is not so easily customizable because the integration is not very good. And it has a nice look by default. As cons, you could say that the support is a bit limited, so there's one person supporting and developing the package, and like some community members, but really the main developer. Probably it's not always completely bug-free because of that. And the interface, because it comes from the R world, is not very Pythonic, you could say. And the adoption is not very wide, but at least when I gave this lecture last year, I think from this point on the adoption has definitely grown. So I saw some like talks or lectures on the internet where this is now already also perceived as like something that you should use. So this is growing, that is cool. Then we have Seaborn, like that is the other big Python plotting package, I would say. So this is also called like a grammar of graphics, but it is more like a very high level plotting language, plotting package built on matplotlib. So it is a real Python package, and it has very powerful features, and it is very customizable with matplotlib, so it integrates very nicely, and it also looks very good by default, and has good support and wide adoptions. But to be honest, it is not a real grammar of graphics, so it is more like, so to say, an add-on to matplotlib, where you say, okay, I have now a few other plots that I can make, and I can easily do a lot of things that I couldn't do before, but it is not as composable as ggplot, I would say. And then there's, like, since like a year or so, maybe a bit longer, there's Altair. So Altair is basically built on Vega Lite. So Vega Lite is a plot specification that's built on JavaScript. However, so what this package does is you have your Python data and you write Python code, and it generates under the hood a Vega Lite specification that can be rendered. So that means, because it's built on JavaScript, it is very nice for interactive plotting, and it's also very composable grammar. The support is very active, and it also looks good by default. And the drawbacks are that because it's built on Vega Lite, you cannot customize it with matplotlib, and it is not really so wide adopted yet, and also rather big pain point is that that it's not so easily to export it to other formats. So if you have something built on Matplotlib, you can always render to anything that Matplotlib supports, which is anything. So any image or PDF format or whatever. But with this, you can only export to SVG. And if you want to put this in a paper, it's already a bit difficult to do this. So we will talk today about introduce the grammar of graphics with ggplot, and then also talk about a bit about Seaborn, because it is at least it's after all a very powerful package. And not next lecture, but not next week, but the lecture afterwards, we will talk about doing more interactive stuff, and then also with Altair. So, and then you should have a good overview about the options that you have, and you can choose which one you like best. So to get started, we import pandas and matplotlib and this datasets package, and we will focus today basically the whole lecture on a single dataset, which is the cast dataset, and which also reminds me that I should clear the output. So the cast dataset is probably not by itself very interesting, so this is about rather old cars and their characteristics, but it is at least an interesting data set from the point of view that it has a lot of different variables and combines continuous and categorical and ordinal features, so we can demonstrate the full power of the grammar of graphics with it. So these are just to get an overview. There are things about like how fast the cars is, how many cylinders they have. This is like displacement is like Hubraum in German, which so I also don't really understand. So basically how big the cylinder is, I believe. Then the horsepower is the consumption of gas here, and where it came from which country, and in which year, and how heavy it is. So we fill up some NaN values, so to avoid some problems just with the median. And then we actually start with the grammar of graphics. So with ggplot, so we start by importing star from plot9. So this is something that you usually wouldn't do, that you import star from a package, but you would rather prefix it, at least with some like short code like NumPy, SNP or so. However, because the package is designed in a way that you really would very often need to type this prefix, it is like more often that you do it like this. So I wouldn't do this in like real development, but for interactive data analysis, I think it's rather okay. So this will import all the functions and classes defined in plot9 into our global namespace now. And we see this right away to get started. So there's now a ggplot object that we can use. And how you start building a plot in ggplot is you first pass some data sets. So we now want to make a plot about the cars. So we say, okay, ggplot of cars. And what we see is, well, we see not really anything, but just an empty shard that we get here. This is because, okay, now we know that we have a ggplot, but we didn't specify really what we want to plot from the data set. So then the next step that we would do is we need some mapping between the variables of our data set and the aesthetics defined on our plot. So and this is what you pass as a second argument to ggplot, and you wrap this in a so-called ACE object, and this stands for aesthetics, and there you just pass the mapping as keyword arguments, and you say, okay, I want to map the X aesthetics, so the X position, to the acceleration variable. And when we do this, we see that there's not really much more, but we see that something has changed, so we now get an axis label that is put here automatically on the x-axis, and we also see that we already have ticks and tick labels. So what is done here that is that the scale for the x-position is now automatically fit to the data, so we see, okay, acceleration probably is in the range between 5 and 25, so this is where the x-scale is now positioned, and also the axis label is drawn automatically. And now what we need to do, now that we have data and a mapping, we need some geometry objects that we can display on our plot. And we do this by using the overridden plus operator that is overridden between the space ggplot object and every geometry object. And we just say plus and then any geometry object that we have at our hands here, and we start by using geomrug, which means is a rug plot, and let's just show you. So this is how it looks. So a rug plot is really just for every data point that we have in our data set, we draw a single point here. So, and this has a name because, like, if you have an old rug, it probably has some of those things at the end as well. And we now see that we have this plot here, and we just declaratively specified, okay, this is our data, this is our mapping, this is our geometry, and the rest was done by the package or by the rendering engine, so to say. So the best way to form a ggplot code, in my opinion, is the following, that you say, okay, so you wrap the whole expression for your ggplot in brackets, and then you, like, on the first line, you put ggplot and the data set and your mapping, and then every geom that you add, you put on a separate line, and then in the final line, you close this off by the closing parentheses here. And this is very nice because now we can just comment out every single geom that you have here, if you have more, and then you can just see how this influences your plot. So we see this just gives the same result, okay. And now just to demonstrate why it's so useful to use something like grammar of graphics is that now if we would like to map this variable not to the X position but to the Y position, really all we need to change in our code is that we say here, okay, map this to Y instead of X, and then we will see that now we have the axis label and the data on the Y axis instead of the X axis, and this really intuitively follows what you would think when you write down this code. So ggplot or plot9 defines a layered grammar of graphics. That means that you can add together different layers of things. So if we just add a second geometry object, so geom density in this case, we would see that we get now two things. We get the rug layer that we had before, but we also now get on a density layer where the density is estimated and drawn, and we now also automatically get a Y label that says, okay, this displays the density here. So, and what we already saw is that we just added here the empty geoms without specifying any data or any aesthetic mapping, and this works because by default, this is inherited from the base object. So if we add this to a ggplot object where we already have data and an aesthetic mapping, this will just be reused in this geometry object without explicitly specifying it. However, at every point, you always have the opportunity to override these defaults. So you could, in theory, pass a new data set or change the aesthetic mapping or also customize the geom with other keyword attributes. So, and this is what we will do here. We will see, okay, we say here geom density, say color equals red, and say, okay, now this inherits the mapping from the base object, but we can add a second density layer and say, okay, now we pass a different aesthetic mapping and say, okay, X should now map to the horsepower instead of the acceleration. And we put this in blue, and because ggplot will not by default figure out a correct axis label for this, we pass an explicit axis label, which is in this package called labs, and we say, okay, the X label should be acceleration and horsepower, and then we get like two densities on the same plot that are now mapped to different variables from our data set. So yeah, really at any point you can just override what you have in the base object, but usually it makes sense to specify something in the base object because usually you want to plot the same data just with different geoms. But yeah, it depends on the use case. Okay, so now that we know the basics of ggplot, we will look at different ways of exploring single and joint variables and so, but maybe before, are there any questions regarding like the basic idea behind ggplot? Okay. Yeah, then we're going to look at different ways to explore single variables. So where we really just want to focus on a single column from our data set here. And we already talked about options for doing this in the matplotlib lecture, but we will reiterate what we learned here and see how we can do this in ggplot. So you might know the simplest form of plotting a distribution of a single variable is just using a histogram. So in this ggplot, it's called geomhistogram. So you just add this, and then you get a histogram. And we also get a warning, because by default, it will use a histogram with 18 bins, but it will not in any way fit this to the data or so. So we should think about using a different number of bins or a different bin width. So, however, I also want to show you is that something like geomhistogram is already like a higher level geometry object, and it's actually just composed out of lower level things. And to show this, I will show you how you can make the same histogram just by using these lower level objects. So there's also something called geombar, and every layer that we add to a ggplot always has a geometry object and a stats object. And these already have different defaults, so bar has a default, and if you just pass that bin, it will also have a default, but we can do it like this, that we say, okay, I want to add bars to the plot, and as a statistic, I want to bin the data somehow, and you can explicitly pass this, and this will give us the same result. So this is actually what a histogram is, right? It's just bars that maps to the counts of data that is put in different bins. And so we can explicitly construct this here using really like low-level primitives. And so we can also make very fancy plots using these low-level primitives. So as I already said, we should maybe choose a different number of bins or a different bin width, so we can to reveal the patterns of the underlying data. So we can just pass like bins equals to 40. However, what's also possible is that we basically the question is, how would we do a normalized histogram? So in like package like matplotlib, we have a special option on the histogram function that says like density, I believe, so that you really but in ggplot you have like more composable ways of achieving this. So what you can do is that you access variables that are not directly defined in the data set, but that are just computed on the fly. So what we can do here is we say, okay, we map x to acceleration, but we on the y, we don't want to have the count now, but we would like to have the density. And to access this density that is only implicitly computed on the data, we wrap this whole expression in stat. And by doing this, we will have access to this variable, and we can compute a normalized histogram. And to verify that is true, we plot the density on top, and we see, okay, this is the density, and this is now the normalized histogram. And this is how you can access these variables that are only implicitly defined. So there are several ones, there are also like count or so, that you could access this way. So then there are also box plots that you could do just by using geomboxplot, and yeah, by default it will look like this. And this already brings us to the first exercise. Okay, I have the problem again that the solution is not hidden here, so I will do it like this. Okay, and we will, for the exercises, I have like maybe two data sets or so, but we will start with the Bali data set and just looking at it. So this is like a famous experiment that was done to compute, or not, to find out like which Bali variations or varieties grow very good on different sites. So basically, it was done in the 1930s in Minnesota. So we have yields for 10 different varieties of barley at 6 different sites. And so this is, yeah, was also popularized in the book The Design of Experiments. So it's like since then used to demonstrate new statistical techniques. So, and your tasks now would be to make a histogram of the yield for all observations, and to make the bins 5 units wide, so 5 yield units, whatever these yield means, maybe it's like kilogram per something or so, so that you get like an intuition about how much yield we can expect. And yeah, so as usual, the notebook is up on Binder, so we can do it there. You can do it on your own if you pull the latest changes from GitHub. Yeah, so enjoy this. Okay, so who was already able to make a histogram of the yield? Okay, what's the difficulty for the others? Yeah. Okay, that's a problem. By like on your local machine or on Binder? Okay. Yeah, maybe just try to reload. Page or so. Yes.
When I run the GG flood code, I get a lot of deprecated warnings. So why is this for me? I'm not having any of that.
Like depends if we have the same version installed. Yes, that's true, but not necessarily like all the versions are specified. So if you like update the stuff on a later time point, some deprecation warnings might be removed. So this is often a problem because they want to keep compatibility with older NumPy matplotlib versions. And then if you have like the newer matplotlib version or so, you get deprecation warnings. But as long as it works, this should not concern you. But except it's like you can always open a pull request on plotline to get rid of these warnings. But yeah, if you want to, we can check later if we have the same version or so. Okay, but for now, let's just look at the solution. So the idea is just the same as with the cast data set. You specify the data frame that you want to plot on. You specify the mapping, where you say, okay, I want to have the yield on the x-axis, and then you do the geom histogram, and you can also pass the bin width to say, okay, I want each bin to be 5 units wide, and then you also need to execute this beforehand. And then, let's not start the countdown again, so like this, yeah. And this is how the plot should look. Are there still problems with Binder, or? Okay. So it worked now, or?
Yeah, just restarted the camera.
Okay. Good. So then let's continue with the next part, which is now that we know how we can explore the statistical distribution of a single variable, we want to look at the relation of one continuous and one categorical variable. So, and what is like very common is that now that we categorical variables, we can just split our continuous variable in different groups, one for each category, and then we can do the same plots that we did before for a single variable now for each group. And ggplot just makes this very easy. So what you just have to do is, like, we have still the acceleration as a continuous variable, but now we use origin as a categorical variable, so cars are either from US, from Japan, I believe, or from Europe. And then we just say, okay, I want x to be on the origin and y on y map to the acceleration, and then we just call boxplot with like just before, and now we automatically get our data separated by these groups and get a boxplot drawn for every categorical variable. And this works because ggplot can figure out that this is a categorical variable and knows, like, okay, this is the smartest thing to do given these variables and this specification. So what you can also do in addition to this plain box plot is that you like put the original data points on top of the box plot to get a feel for the real data points. And that because if you put all the data points just on top, they would all be on the same exposition and would overlap each other. So what we do is we apply some adjustment, which is in this 4 points called jittering. So we just randomly disturb the position of the original points. And so we just say, okay, I want to geom jitter with some given width, and then we now have the original points like a bit randomly distributed around the middle of the box plot here on top of the original box plot. And this way we can see, okay, there are in this case, I would say, much more data points from the US than from Europe, so maybe this distribution is more reliable than what we have here. Then you also know violin plots, and you can do them also here just by calling geom underscore violin, and you get a violin plot for each group then. And then there's also something called, then in this case, not you don't start with the geom, but you start with the statistics, and now the statistic has also a geom by default associated. So stat summary would do this, and it would plot like the mean and the standard deviation by default. So this is also nice if you want to add this. And what you can also do is you can combine violin and box plots to get like the benefits of both, and you now have the violin plot, and in the middle you have the box plot, and you see, okay, these two go both to the minimum and the maximum of the data range, but now you see like the non-parametric estimate of the distribution plus the mean and plus the median and the quantiles in a single plot. So this is usually very informative if you look at distributions for the first time. What you can also do is you can just look at the density, and you can split those by something else. So in this case we look at the miles per gallon, and we want to split by the origin. So, and in this case we don't map to the X position, but we map to the fill variable, which is like the color with which the density things are filled, and we make the alpha value of the density a bit lower, so we see the overlap better. And this just gives us this plot and draws a density estimate now for each group in this variable and puts them all on top of each other. So we can see that, I think, so if you have more miles per gallon, like your gas consumption is lower, I would say, right? So they're more efficient. So we can see that the most efficient cars in this case come from Japan. Europe is in the middle here, and US has the least efficient cars, so to say, at least looking at this plot here. And you can just do the same with histograms, where you just say, okay, instead of adding the density, I add a histogram geom, and you specify the bins. And in this case, we would also say position identity, which means, okay, the bars should not be stacked on top of each other, but they should really overlap each other. So just maybe to demonstrate this, as we turn this off, we would get a histogram like this, where we would have, like, when we have a bar in the same position, we just put the bar on top. But I find this always a bit hard to read. Yeah, and just like to demonstrate again why it is so convenient to use something like the grammar of graphics instead of matplotlib. Here's like the same thing attempted to be done in matplotlib. So what we would do here, okay, we can at least put like what we want to plot and what we want to split by the variables as strings first, and then we would need NumPy to find the bin edges of the histogram, so we can use the bin edges or the same bins for all the different groups. Then we need to make a figure, then we need to make an explicit group by the variable that we want to split by. We need to iterate over this group by. We do put a histogram on the axis for each group that we have here, so the variable to plot, and then we say, okay, data is group, and then we need to specify the labels again here, and then we need to set the X labels and the Y label explicitly, and then we need to call the legend explicitly, and then we get a plot that looks approximately like the one above here. So however you see that, like, there are a lot of like low level details that you now need to think about, like what to draw where and how do you need to split the data manually, so to say. So you need to call group by yourself and compare to two lines. This is like, you know, like 8 lines or so. So, and this is why it's really powerful to have something like to be in command of something like ggplot, so that you can really quickly iterate over statistical visualizations and don't always need to spend a lot of time thinking just about how you want the plot to be done. Yeah. And so now we come to the next exercise to, and now the exercise would be to, again, on the Bali data set, make a violin plot of the yield variable, but in this case, make it for each site that we have in the data set. And then also jitter the original data points on top of the violin, so you can see like how many data points there actually were. So as I hope now that no one's kernel is crashing again, let's try this in 3 minutes. Okay, so who was able to do it? Okay, very good. So then let's just check the solution. So yeah, once you have figured out how to do this, this is like really easy to do. You just map to the site for the x position and the yield to the y position, and then you say, okay, give me a violin, give me jitter on top, and this is it. So, and what can we see in this plot? Well, we can see about like how the variations were between the different sites. So, for example, Duluth probably has the lowest variation in the yield, but the Sika has the highest yield or so. Okay, so next up we will look at exploring the relation between two continuous variables. So one easy way to do this is just make a scatter plot, and you achieve this by mapping one continuous variable to the x position, in this case horsepower, and one to the y position, this is the weight now of the car, and then you just say g on point, and then for each data point you get a point drawn and at the respective x and y position. And we can already see that there is some kind of relationship. If the horsepower grows, then the weight grows, maybe. Or maybe it's also the other way around, but it's at least a relation between these two variables. One problem that these kind of plots have, if you just make a scatter plot, is overplotting. So overplotting means that if you have two data points and map to the more or less the same position, you will not see that there are many data points mapped to the same position. So we already see this here. It's really hard to count like how many data points are there. But in theory, it's also possible that this data point here is there a million times, but we just see it once because all the million data points are at the very same position. So to avoid this, there are a bunch of techniques that you can use. So one possibility would be to use a two-dimensional density estimate. So instead of using the points, you just have a estimate of the two-dimensional statistical distribution with these level lines here, and we would see, okay, here's the highest density, and then the density fans out, and here's again a bit higher density. And you can also change like how many levels you will display by default if you pass the levels keyword here to get a bit more fine-grained view of the data. And what you can also do, you can color this density plot by doing the following. So you say, okay, instead of using geom density 2D, you use the statistic density 2D, and then you explicitly pass a geometry object that you want to use for it, in this case a polygon, and you re-specify the mapping. So you reuse the x and y mapping, that's okay, but additionally you want to map the fill variable, or the fill aesthetic, and you want to map this to the level variable. Again, the level variable is not defined in our original data set, but it is computed on the fly when we use density 2D. So we can just wrap level instead, and then we can pass this to the fill aesthetic. And this is then the plot that we get for this. We now also have like a color bar for the different density levels. Then another way of avoiding overplotting is to use geom count, so to make a count plot in this case. And what this does, it will, for points that are very close together, it will group them together and just make a bigger point. and it will also produce a legend that says, okay, what's the proportion of this data point with respect to the whole data set. So, and we see here that, okay, this point was not there a million times because it is small as it was before, but here were actually some points that were there multiple times, and also here and here where the data already looked a bit dense, there are like bigger, or there are more data points. Then another thing that is interesting when you want to talk about relations of continuous variables is to use some form of regression. So to say, okay, if instead of just look at the data and draw all the points, but draw maybe a regression line through all these data points. And we can achieve this by using geom.smooth. And what this will do by default, it draws a line. It tries to draw a smooth line through all the data points. And also give like an estimate of the standard error around, like an error band around this regression here. So by default, this is possible because the statistic that is used here is it's just a regression method, and this is a so-called lowest smoothing or local regression, or so local weighted linear regression. So you look at a window of all the data points in the neighborhood and try to compute like a best fit to only this window, and this way you get like this smooth line here. So if you think that this is not an appropriate way to fit your data, just drawing a smooth line, but you say, okay, the relationship is actually linear, you can also use a linear model. So you can pass method equals LM for a linear model instead, and this will just draw then a straight line through your data and also give like an estimate of the standard error here. And we see, okay, as we already guessed from just looking at the raw data, that horsepower is probably related to weight in some way. And what is what we can also do if we want, if we add like another variable now, so we say, okay, we now want to color the points by the origin, we now add another categorical variable to our two continuous variable, and what this will do, this will influence all the layers that we subsequently add. So it will color all the points differently, but it will also estimate linear model now for each of the groups. So we now get three lines, and we see, okay, they have different offsets, but the slope looks really similar, so to say. So maybe this relation between horsepower and weight is not influenced by where the car is built, but instead maybe just like Europe and Japan rather build cars here in the lower, or just have different offsets, more or less, so to say. Okay. And here we also pass standard error, so SE equals false. So if we pass true, I think we would get additional error bands here. Yeah. But okay, this is now semi-useful because now the error bands overlap. Yeah, and what you can also do is you can actually use text to plot things. So there's a geom called geomText, and if you pass this and you say, okay, vertical alignment equals top, what this does is by default for each point, and this uses the label aesthetic, so there's an aesthetic called label, and there we pass name, and name is defined in our data set. If we look at this again, so this is the name of the car. And this allows us to, this is here, this is the name of the car. And now this will automatically draw this name in the plot at the position of the original point. So if you have things with names in your data set, this is usually also an interesting way to like quickly figure out where things are in the data space. However, be aware that if you use a geom, this will always be related to your data, or this will always be placed in the plot based on what you have in the data. So now for each data point we will get a label here. If you just want to annotate your plot, this means that add extra annotation that is not directly related to the data, but where you just want to highlight special points where you say, okay, I want to put a label here or want to put an arrow there, then you should use the annotate function and not use geom text. Yeah, okay, so this brings us to the next exercise where we look at a different data set now, at the country's data set again that we probably didn't have before. No. Okay. And this contains developmental indices for many countries over the world, so things like literacy and GDP. And what I want you to do is now plot literacy versus gross domestic product, and then fit a smooth lowest curve through the points. And maybe at this point also think about if these variables do relate to each other or not. Okay, so maybe most people are already done. Okay, then it's just... look at the solution. So, yeah, again, it is kind of follows from what you would think. You want to map the GDP to the X position, literacy to the Y position, and then put points and a smooth line on top of each other. So what do you think? Do GDP and literacy relate to each other? Yeah, sorry? Yeah. So as people gain the ability to read, they get rich, we could say. However, at a point, so if you almost have 100% literacy, you might still be on a larger spectrum of the GDP, so not all people who can read are equally rich, apparently. So this might be an interpretation of this plot. Well, okay. So now we saw how we can relate like two continuous variables, and already saw like if we have a third categorical variable, but now we want to have more dimensions with more aesthetics. And this is very easy to do with ggplot. We again look at our CAST data set and we see that we have like a lot more variables than what we already saw. So we already looked at acceleration and horsepower and weight and name in some way, but not really in conjunction with this. So we now start by what we already did, by saying, okay, we make a scatter plot for horsepower against weight, and we want to color by the miles per gallon, and this is a way to add like a third continuous variable to the plot. We just map to color and call geompoint, and ggplot will figure out, okay, this is a continuous variable, I need to make a continuous color scale, or use a continuous color scale, and this way we can see, okay, that the cars with the lowest consumption are like down here, where we have low horsepower and low weight, but cars with high consumption are rather in this area here. So now there are other aesthetics that we can use to add additional continuous variables. So if you now want to add the displacement, so this is like the size or the volume of the piston in the cylinder, we can use the size aesthetic. So we just say size map to displacement, and this will make the points, the size of the points related to the variable in, so to the displacement variable. So in this way, again, we can see that apparently also if you have high miles per gallon, you are down here where you have like also low displacement, but things with higher displacement are more in this quadrant down here. And so we just skip this for now, and we can add now another categorical variable to the shape by using the shape aesthetic. So we can say, okay, give me the origin based on the shape, and we can, this way ggplot will figure out, okay, I have a continuous variable, categorical variable map to the shape, so I have three categories, let's make three different shapes. So we have now here circles, triangles, and something that looks kind of roundish as well. And we can see that like these are probably squares then. So we can see that like a lot of US cars are like squares down here, whereas we have the cars from Japan and Europe rather down here. So we see that this way we now already have combined 5 different variables in a single plot, again just using 2 lines of code. And now we should practice this techniques again on the countries data set. So just continue on the plot from above, where we plot literacy against GDP with information about the population density, the country's climate, and whether or not the countries are part of the European Union. And so just now, I don't say what to map to what exactly, but you just should try to find a mapping that somehow keeps the plot interpreter where you can read from it. And to keep things a bit more clear, you can remove the regression line from the plot above, because otherwise it's really a bit too much on the same plot. Okay, for this, like, say you have 5 minutes time to look a bit around, but if you are done earlier, you can also notify me. Okay, so what kind of mappings did you come up with to display the data? Anyone interested in sharing their results? Yeah.
For example, the shape for the in EU column. Because there are only two different values.
Yeah.
Yeah,
exactly. That's a good idea. Let's see what I have here. So I use the size for population density and color for climate and shape for NU. And looks. Let's look at how this looks. We get a bunch of warnings. However, we see, okay, it's like this. So, okay, we have the NU countries rather here at the top. So most people in the EU can apparently read. Then we also see the climate. So it's probably like where it's warmer. Okay, so there's probably not a real relation between climate and this whole thing. And then we see, okay, population density is also somewhat mixed here. But yeah, so this is an example that you could choose. However, there are probably also other mappings that would be useful. So this is like a way to combine a lot of variables on the same plot. However, this has some limitations. Now if we start to, I don't know, make the edges of the points squiggly in response to another categorical variable or so, it will be impossible to actually see what's going on. However, there is another technique to allow us to put even more dimensions in the same plots, and this technique is called faceting, or sometimes also called trellis plots, or the technique of small multiples, or whatever, but we will stick with facets here. And the idea behind this is that you say, okay, I have my normal plot here with x and y and then the plot, and then I want to facet wrap by some categorical variable. And what this does is now it repeats the same plot now for each group, so to say, and writes a group on top here. And what is also very important, that it keeps the scales on all the facets the same, so to make it comparable. So we do not get for each subplot a new scale, but all the points are plotted on the same y scale here and on the same x scale. So we can directly see that, okay, there are a lot more heavy cars in the US than in Europe and Japan. And so looking at this and coming back to our previous example, we will see how we can add additional variables to our plot that we had before. So we still had left the cylinder variables, and we can facet wrap by the cylinders. So now we get a plot like this. We say, okay, for the groups of 3, 4, 5, 6, and 8 cylinders, we have these different plots now. And again, we can see that, okay, since US is this square shape now, that a lot of 8-cylinder cars come from the US, whereas 3-cylinder cars are apparently were only produced in Europe. 5-cylinder cars, no, this is Japan, right? 3-cylinder cars are only in Japan. And then, yeah, these 5-cylinder cars only in Europe, and so on. Here's a mixture. And what you can also do, you can customize the way that the wrapping is done for the facets. So we can say, okay, that we want to have two columns, and this now keeps, or yeah, restricts the number of columns to 2. And once the second column is reached, it starts again and wraps around here, and this is why it's called facet wrap. In contrast to facet wrap, there's also facet grid, where you explicitly map variables to rows and columns. So what we do here now is we convert the year variable to an int, so it can be easier included. So we use this dt datetime accessor and get the year. And we can see, okay, how many cars were there in the different years right away, and we assign this to the variable year int now. And what we can do now is we use facet grid, and we pass a list here of these two variables, so cylinders and year int. So this now will be mapped to the rows and this to the columns, I would say. And this already takes some time because there's now really a lot of plotting going on, but in the end we still get our plot where we now have here, we see that the year is now on the columns and the number of cylinders is now on the rows. And we see, okay, that there are a lot of combinations where nothing was there. So there were no five-cylinder cars were apparently only on vogue from 1978 to 1980. Then probably people figured out that it was a bad idea. I don't know. And yeah, we can also see that maybe the eight-cylinder cars, at least here, weren't produced as many as were here before, and so on and so on. So, and looking at the data frame again, we see that we now almost included all the variables in a single plot, except for the name and the acceleration. And I think adding extra text labels to these small plots would not really help anything at all. So in this case, we just like add the acceleration variable to finalize this. And to do this, we turn it into a categorical variable. So let's look at the description here, and we see that we have some quantiles here. So we use the qcut function from pandas introduced like in an earlier lecture, and we say, okay, we want to cut the distribution in three quantiles in slow, middle, and fast cars, and add this to our data frame. And now what we can also do is we can add a second variable or a combination of variables to our facet grid here. So what we do here is we say we want to have cylinders and the categorical acceleration on the rows and the year on the columns, and we do this by this syntax. So instead of just passing a list, you can also pass a single string where you have like this tilde in the middle that separates rows from the columns. And this is also coming from the R world, where like this would actually represent a literal R syntax where you can relate different variables using formulas, and then you would use this tilde sign to create a formula. But this is now just parsed internally by ggplot. And now we look at this again and wait some time here. And now we see that now we have the combination of all of the three categories of slow cars and cylinders and fast cars and middle cars and so on. And the cylinders, and we see that not all combinations are realized, because so we only get rows for the combinations where we actually have data points. So there are no slow cars who have, or there are actually slow cars who have eight cylinders. Well, okay, but for example, what is not there? There are apparently no slow cars who have five cylinders, because we don't have a row for this. So in this way, we can like grow our plot even more, and we could do like the same for the columns, and we could add extra variables to get even more combinations. But we leave it for now with this. And just to show you again, so this would be like the R syntax of doing things, where we use plus and tilde. But we can also use, in the Python world, use more Pythonic notation, where we just have a list of lists, and then like for the rows we have a list with two elements, and then for the columns we just have a single element. So, and I think this is a bit more clearer than using this R formulas, which have no real equivalent in Python. And just to show you here, so we also use theme here. So theme is a function where you can like adjust the appearance of the plot. And in this case, we just made the figure size a bit bigger, so we could actually still see something. So yeah, and that's it for this ggplot exploration. So we combined now eight variables in a single figure using only four lines of code. So, and this should show you that ggplot is very powerful, and that you can really quickly iterate and make graphics that give insights and reveal patterns in the data set very easily. So, and as an exercise for this, we look again at the Bali data set, and now the task would be to make a box plot for the 2 years. So we have the year experiment, and for each experiment, and then facet the plot by the site variable. So just to practice this faceting. Yeah, and there's also a hint available if you need any. Okay, so let's look at the solution, or first at the hint. So as you might have seen, if you simply assign year to the x-static, this is interpreted as a continuous variable. So, and to avoid this and to get this really to be used by the facet, you can either explicitly turn it into a categorical variable, or you can wrap the assignment in the factor expression. And this is, again, like comes from the R world, where like factor is a real data type in R, where you just say, okay, this represents a category, so to say. This is now also what I did here, where we say, okay, x equals factor of year, and then y to the yield. And then we add the box plot, and we facet wrap by the side. And then this looks like this, where we get for each side, we get these two box plots that are split by year, and we can... Well, what do we see? We see that the yield went down on all sides except in Morris, for example. So apparently 1932 was not as good for growing barley as was the previous year. Okay, so now to as a final point, we look at the killer feature of ggplot, which is xkcd seams. So you can do this by adding seam xkcd, and then your plot looks like this, and this will get your paper published without review. Then, however, this is actually just a feature of matplotlib, and it's also available there. So I wrote this here. You can also do like with plt xkcd, and then your plots will look like this. Also, if you are inclined to creating memes, that might be useful. Okay, so for some further readings, so the plot 9, so to say, the Python ggplot documentation is okay, but in the R world you will find like a lot of really nice examples of using ggplot, and usually you can transfer them directly to Python. However, sometimes you use some add-ons that might not be available, but you can look here to see like a good overview over things that you can do with ggplot. So there are a lot of like fancy plots that you can make using this powerful grammar of graphics. And yeah, and there's also other stuff that you can see, but it's usually a good idea to also look at the R solutions if you want to do something in ggplot in Python. Okay, so we have 10 minutes left, so I would suggest that we at least start with Seaborn. This is not as detailed as the treatment of ggplot anyway, so as I already set Seaborn takes a bit of a different approach. It's not that really composable grammar where you can just add and add things together and create plots like this, but you rather have like a larger set of named functions. There you can say, okay, this plot already produces what I want, and then you might tweak the plot a bit to get like to look really like you want. But so the approach is a bit different and not really as powerful, but the Seaborn has a lot of really nice plots. So it's also good to know about it. So one big strength of Seaborn is definitely styling. So you import Seaborn usually as SNS. That's the convention. And then you can call SNS.set, which sets all the style defaults to Seaborn. And then we again restore our cars data set here. And then to just see that it's really easy to gather a lot of meaningful plots with Seaborn, we can just call pairplot on the whole data set. And then we get a big scatter plot that tries to plot all the variables against all the other variables. And we see, okay, now on the diagonal, we get histograms for the single variables. But for all the other stuff, we get scatter plots, where one variable is plotted against the other. So you can see a lot of relations in your data set just by calling the single command. And as we already see, really the styling is very nice, so they have like really nice colors and so by default, so this looks very good. And Seaborn also supports this idea of aesthetic mapping to a certain extent. You don't have to wrap things in a separate ace object, but instead you just pass the mapping directly as keyword arguments to the plotting functions. So you could say like hue equals origin, or hue is mapped to origin, and pass this as additional argument to pairplot, and then we would get the different groups in the data set colored by the different things. So and you already see, okay, now color is now named, not named color anymore, but it's now named hue to avoid collisions with the matplotlib color argument. And this is like where it would be a bit nicer to have like a separate aesthetic mapping object, but in this case, you just have to remember that hue in this case is for aesthetic mapping and color is for setting the color statically. And now we also see that here we now get density estimates instead of histograms because we now have no three variables, and but still the plot is very, looks very nice. So then we can do the things just as we did before, where we say, okay, we want to explore single variables. And here we see, okay, we have now named plots like this plot that combine histograms with density estimates. So this is what we did before manually, where we said, okay, I want to have an histogram and map the height to the density and then add a density. So and this is what seaborn does like by default. So seaborn really has a lot of powerful defaults, but sometimes it's not so easily to change if you want to have something else. And then we see here that we can pass like a single panda series directly if we just pull out a single column, but it will also support like, or the default should be that you have this similar syntax to ggplot where you have like the mapping first and then you pass the data, where you say, okay, the data should be cars and then the variable that I want to plot should be acceleration. And this would give us here a box plot in this case. And we can continue to do this by mapping things to x and y and the data, and then this will be split again by the categorical variable, so this works again like it is in ggplot. And what is nice, seaborn also supports, is a so-called swarm plot. So this is like an alternative to jittering points randomly. So what this does, it aligns points that have the same value side by side, so it kind of gives a similar look like a violin plot, but only using real data points without any estimation done. So this is also a very interesting way of looking at a raw data distribution and see, okay, here we have really many points and how many points you have in total. And when you want to combine different named plots on the same figure, you don't add them together. You just call them one after another, so to say, and they will be combined on the same plot. So if you want to combine a box plot with a swarm plot, as we did here, we just call one after the other. And this is like similar to matplotlib, because implicitly this will create a new matplotlib figure, and this will open this figure, and then the next call to seaborn will look, okay, is there already a figure open? And if yes, then just plot on the same figure. So this is one way to do it. A nicer way to do this a bit more explicitly would be to explicitly create the matplotlib figure yourself and then pass the axes object to the seaborn functions, so you have more control over this. Then there's also violin plots. They look like this, and you see again here by default they have these small box plots drawn on top of the violin plots, so seaborn really tries to give like a lot, give really good defaults, and just with single functions already give you plots that are very meaningful, where you don't have to compose so much, but like it's always a trade-off whether you want to have like more control or more defaults done for you. Okay, so let's create a binary variable here to show you a nice twist for the violin plots in seaborn. So we just cut the year variable of the cars in two, separating them in young and old cars. And when we pass this to the hue variable now for the violin plot, and we say split equals true, or split should be true, then what will happen is that the violin plot will now have two sides. So this will be like still the whole distribution of acceleration for US cars, but on the left we see like the side for the old cars, and on the right the distribution for the young cars. And this is usually a good way if you have binary, or if you have a binary group and you want to see like the difference between those two groups, that really these two distributions are now laid on on top of each other, and you can really see the differences in those things. So we might assume that cars got a bit faster with growing time here, at least in the US and also in Europe, I would say, whereas in Japan, I think it relatively stayed the same. And there's also a factor plot if you want to explore the variable or the relation between continuous and categorical variables. And so in general, just to understand seaborne maybe a bit better, so seaborne distinguishes between like axis level plots and figure level plots. So figure level plots would be things that create a new matplotlib figure for you, and axis level plots would be things where you can explicitly pass a matplotlib axis and just draw on top of these axes. And then usually the figure level plots have named like a factor plot or so that are like not really based on what they draw, but rather on what they are meant to be used for. So what kind of data they are meant to be used for, whereas a violin plot, just okay, it draws a violin, but it doesn't mean that, so to say that this really should be used to distinguish different factors in your data set. And with this, with these figure level functions, you often have a kind argument where you say, okay, I want to use this kind of plot to display the relationship between this kind of data. And yeah, it's easier to find around in the seaborne function universe. So this is like similar to joint plot, where we say, okay, joint plot is like, it does not describe that it's really what it plots, but it means, okay, it is meant to plot joint distributions where you have like two continuous variables, you have a joint distribution. So we can use a joint plot. And here we say, okay, we want to plot horsepower and weight. And by default, it does a scatter plot and draws like the marginal histogram of the data things. Yeah, and what we see here, we have this thing where we have a kind argument. We say, okay, instead of a scatter plot, I want to use a hex plot, which means, okay, I want to have a two-dimensional density estimate using a hexagonal bins here. And similar, we can pass other kind arguments, like for example regression, where we now add regression lines, and now here we get, in addition to the histogram, we get a density estimate. Or we can use kernel density estimate to get like this kind of plot, where we now have just densities on the marginals. And then there's also linear model plot and so, but maybe, maybe we can. Yeah, we can just stop here, I would say, and we continue there on Thursday just with this introduction to linear model plotting and the exercise, and then how you can customize your plots created with ggplot or seaborne with matplotlib. And I think I will release like the homework in the evening today, and since again it's a plotting homework, there might again be similar problems as we had with the matplotlib exercise, but this should be way less complicated than last time, because you don't need to do so many customizations, right? You just need to specify how the plot is supposed to look, and then it should work, and you don't need to like do so many low-level customizations as you needed to do in the matplotlib exercise. Okay, then, thanks for coming, and see you on Thursday.